waiting for the dawn of abstraction. Abstraction is our true nature. Concreteness is the attempt to die to our true nature. And we're the ones making that attempt. Nothing is forcing that upon us. So we're waiting for abstraction. I considered it this morning to be all forms, everything would have some sort of light around it. This is what Jesus tells us happens when we're really getting close. And so there's a commonality to everything. What's the commonality? A common abstractionness, where this light is not any particular form in particular, right? Light doesn't seem to have any particular form to it. You could say it could take on any form. So when everything has these little edges of light to it, that means you're feeling like there's a commonality of abstraction to everything. Nothing is actually 100% the actual form that we think, the concrete form that we think we're seeing. It has a tinge of abstraction to it. And everything has that tinge of abstraction to it. This is what we're hoping for. This is what I've been hoping for my whole life. It still hasn't happened, and so I'm not very pleased about that. But maybe today, it's a very hot day, is extraordinarily different than yesterday. The massive heat wave from Southern California has pushed up into the Bay Area, and it is hazy, it is muggy, hazy, and hot. I mean, it feels like the Southern California, feels like we're in Los Angeles right now. Took a reading in the Coachella Valley, and it said 125. Well, this particular recording station is always over the top. You know, it's always too hot. It's actually only 119 out there right now. So it's very interesting, and you almost feel like, you know, how come abstraction cannot just push into the picture someday? You know, why can it not do that? I had a dream last night. I felt like playing golf for some reason. I went to a golf course, and I was welcome there, and I was feeling like, well, I won't be able to get out. I don't want to really go out with a bunch of people, you know, and I guess go out as a single. And they said, here's a golf cart. Just go get your, you know, here's a golf ball. We'll give you a free golf ball. Just go out anytime. And there was like nobody there. And I was like, what's going on here? It was very surreal. The whole thing was very surreal. And I looked out on the golf course, and it all seemed like a soft glow. The nature, everything had a soft glow to it. And I was thinking, and then I couldn't remember if I had paid or not. I said, wait a minute, did I even pay? Can I even go out? I hadn't paid. I'm not sure. What's going on here? Very surreal. I can't remember what the golf ball said. It might have said reality or eternity, or had some logo on it that I read. But, you know, this heat wave for me is like, yeah, well, why not abstraction come into the picture? Abstraction being this diffuse edges of light around everything, right? Light being abstract, having no form, seeing all things, everything we perceive, is having the edges of light around it. And therefore, there is this tinge of abstraction to what we're seeing. Everything is tinged with this abstraction. And this is why, how we begin to escape from concreteness, which is really just our pretense. But the problem is, our pretense is so extraordinary that we have troubles to stop pretending, because we think this is us now. Our pretending is so immaculate that we think we can't. If we stop pretending, we'll be annihilated. At least stop pretending to be dead. If we stop pretending, we think pretending is our function. We've been at this so intensely for so long, this pretending. We think without pretending, we wouldn't have any function at all. We'd be non-existent. So let's keep pretending. We pretend to be eternal life, but our true life is completely abstract. There's no definition. We are all potentiality, always. And our no form defines us. We never value appearance. We never value appearance. It cannot define us. It's a flow. It's a constant flow of creativity. But there's nothing that is defining us. So the intermediate step, Jesus says, there is a step where you see everything tinged with light. I haven't seen it yet. And I'm waiting for it. And maybe that dream was showing that I was a little reluctant to get started. Now, we can't really bring the concrete mind with us. When we see abstraction, we're seeing abstraction. If everything is tinged with light, then there's a commonality to all forms. Everything we're seeing has this common denominator, which is light, which is abstraction. So maybe this will happen. I hope so. Just like this heat wave, it was building up. I know this has been building up. Success has been building up. There's no question about it. But it hasn't arrived yet. Just like this massive heat wave in Southern California has been building up. It's been hot there for about the last 2 or 3 days or so, maybe more. And yet in the Bay Area, San Francisco Bay Area, we've just had this liquid, beautiful, liquidy, clear, soft, cool breeze, just like unbelievably nice weather. No heat at all. It's just been fabulous, if you like that. And yet today, the high pressure from down south, it pushed aside the atmosphere, and the atmosphere has completely changed. Completely changed. Wow. Quite extraordinary. So, just like that, isn't it possible that building up all this effort, hasn't seemed to arrive yet? We say, it's never going to arrive. But just finally enough pressure has been built up where it just moves in, and then the whole atmosphere has changed. Everything has changed. And now you can see light around everything, emanating from everything. And we realize that all forms are just the imagined concretization of this light. But it doesn't take away the fluidity of the light. And all forms are actually still completely fluid. They're not any definite, real definition at all. There are no self-existent definitions at all. And then this reminds us of truth. So, in the dream, I didn't tee off on the golf course. I was still saying, asking questions and kind of like wondering, wait, can I really play here without any fee? I thought it'd be too expensive too. I said, wow, I can't afford this. This is some deluxe resort. How can I play golf here? But I just decided to show up and ask anyway. So I guess I should just be sitting there quietly taking it in, the wow of it. This is the right thing to do instead of struggling. If we're struggling, what we need to do is go to the wow. Okay, this is the best advice I have. If our mind is struggling, look for the wow in the situation, and then just sit with that wow. Because you're probably trying to take too much in, go too fast, and you're trying to deal with it mentally, struggling, conceptually. And so, I should just like take a seat in that the golf clubhouse that was open and open to the course. It's very interesting. And just take a seat and just sit there. Because they said anytime, you can tee off anytime. Anytime at all is what they told me. I said, well, I was thinking about, wait a minute, aren't there some foursomes, other people teeing off? I get in their way. They said, no. And I said, just anytime you want to go to the tee, it's open, it's yours. Anytime at all. So actually, I need to sit and absorb the shock of this. This is a very shocking development. Now, can I take along the personality? Probably not. Personality would get all weirded out. Wouldn't understand your relation, etc. So just put the personality in the clubhouse and let them have some lunch and, you know, kick back and do phone calls or whatever, but you go out on the course. And I did see sort of like, I felt like I saw like a soft glow of light around everything. You know, there's a firm, Bokeh, the Bokeh, or something like Bokeh, when you defocus on photography, you defocus, like in Zoom, you're zoomed and you defocus, and the lights, like the street lights, whatever light you're seeing, they suddenly become like diffuse blobs of light, kind of like that, with soft edges to them. This is what I was kind of seeing. I was seeing a lot of that out in nature. I said, well, this looks like a different nature. The colors were very, it looked very beautiful. The colors looked very intense, and yet there was also this glow present, both. And I was just kind of like out of the corner of my eye, kind of looking like, wow, what am I in for here? This really looks like the most extraordinary golf course in the world. And just the guts to go there and say, hey, I'd like to play around a round of golf. And I was just shaking. I was nervous. I mean, I thought I'd be rejected or kicked out. Who are you? You know, it's just the opposite. They said, oh, yeah, sure. Okay. Yeah. Hey, here's a golf cart and you're good to go. Anytime you want to go, it's good to go. That's it. There was no questioning of me at all. And so I think I'm maybe in a state of shock. In fact, I am. So if you check in with the wow and you get in touch with it, then you find out how strong it is. And this morning I was feeling very depressed, saying I'll never make it. But actually, it's a state of shock that I'm in. So this is why walking together in the wow, the discipline we're doing, is so super important on the path. Because we do have these tremendous breakthroughs ahead for us. And when you get close to it, you're going to go into shock, for sure. The shock of the wow. And if we don't recognize it, we'll get depressed. We'll get depressed and the wheels will come off. So that's what I'm here for. I'm here to help with this wow issue and helping you know, shepherd. This is being the good shepherd, shepherding us into these experiences that we need. Going from the concrete to the abstract and getting used to that. I used to have this really cool video camera. I don't even know if you can get them. Maybe you can still get them, but it was probably very expensive. But the good old days where everything was manual. It was a digital Sony digital camera, big one, but it had you could override everything with manual adjustments on everything, focus, exposure. It was just awesome, and I did so much video work with that camera. Unfortunately, I threw all the videos away in a fit of, I didn't recognize the wow of it enough, maybe, and I got impatient. I threw everything away, but I was always with that camera and changing focus and exposure, so everything was like a light show, and it got blurry, and oh my gosh, it was just fantastic, because you could look at anything through that camera lens, and then alter it and change it, so it got all diffuse and glowy, and really extraordinary. And that really was a big, for quite some time, that was my life. I just went everywhere in nature, filming video, took just massive amounts of video with that camera, and then made videos from them, which are, I wish I had them now, but unfortunately, I felt this is going to help someone, and nobody was interested. So I said, to heck with it, you know, this is ridiculous. I've just been, you know, wasting my time. But it really wasn't a waste of my time, because I got accustomed to this higher beauty that is possible for us. And then I did that with my other camera, the Samsung that recently had also, and that was quite extraordinary. It had manual adjustments, some, not all. But and then that broke, so I don't know what's next. Maybe actually is to see it in my mind, to actually perceive this without a camera, using the camera of the brain, mind, whatever. Maybe that's next. So this shepherding, the good shepherd is the one who points out the wow, saying, yes, there are these extraordinary experiences available. And when we get close, we're closing in on them, we're going to go through all these successions of shocks. So I believe I can break this down, you know, into various elements now for us, and we can work on this. The first thing was just going there, the audacity to even go to this place. I mean, would I even be allowed on the grounds or anything? And I met no resistance, nothing. I drove straight in. There's nobody to say anything to me. So I got out of the car and just went into this open clubhouse. It wasn't like, there was no walls to it. It was just these metal posts everywhere holding up a roof, like that kind of thing. It was open. And I went in and there was just a simple little desk there. And I said, I'd like to play around here. Can you get me on sometime? When can I get on? I was hoping I can get on sometime kind of early here. And they said, oh, yeah. Here, okay, go get a cart. Cart guy got the cart. They said, okay, you're good to go. No name, no identity. Nothing was asked of me. They said, yeah, sure. That's it. And so, but I didn't get in the cart immediately. I said, wow, I didn't even bring my bags in from the car because I thought maybe I can't get on. I didn't even bring them in. I said, wow, that was stupid. I should have brought them in. So I had to go get the bags, you know. And then I'm thinking about the personality, like, can I bring that along? There was some other person there. But I said, well, if I ask them, they might say, well, you have to pay extra. But I said, wait a minute, I never paid in the first place. But that kind of felt like, you know, this is something I have to do. You cannot bring the concrete personality along on this trip. So I'm trying to reconcile to that and then actually driving out on the course and looking at it and say, wow, I'm here. Here would mean this change, you know, seeing light around everything probably. So what the function of a teacher of God is to know that these experiences are available and to appraise others that as you get closer to them, there is this shock of the wow, and how to deal with this shock of the wow. This is what's key. So that's what I've been doing. Shock of the wow. So always check into your wow. Find your wow. And this changes your whole perspective. You feel centered again. And you stop struggling and say, oh my gosh, of course I'm in shock. Why wouldn't I be? I mean, I expected like this was just some wild, desperate ploy, you know, with feeling like, boy, this is going to be really tough. And then I met no resistance at all. I said, I'm going to have to go out with other people, you know, personas. I don't want to go out with any personas. You know, this will ruin the experience. I just want to go out there and just experience just how beautiful it is. So I don't want to be in some competition with people. And there's no people. They said, yeah, you're free to go out anytime. Don't worry. There's no trouble with getting in anyone's way at all. Now, I like this. Like today, in you know, say it reaches 120 and Coachella Valley. I'd like to go out and play golf. And, you know, but why? There's nobody out there. There'd be like zero people on the golf course. Maybe one. There's some desert rats down there who might be out because they enjoy the same experience, right? So there might be one or two. They're spread out, you know, and you might see them, might glimpse someone maybe one time and just, and there's no pressure. If you want to just sit for half an hour just looking at this beautiful golf course, this beautiful landscape with the mountains and everything, wow. You can. If somebody comes through and wants to keep playing through, you just motion, you don't have to say anything. Just say, yeah, go ahead. You know, just sort of wave. And they'll just play through. You know, nobody even has to speak. Nobody has to even speak. This is awesome. This is great. This is what I live for. But maybe I can get this all the time without like going to the Coachella Valley. I've not been able to go there for quite some time. No money, no way to do it. If I had the money, oh, for sure. I'd go, you know, somewhere, I don't know, something like that, someplace where it's hot, and you can be out in nature and feel like there's no need to communicate with people, with personas, with concreteness. See, and in heat, everything seems less concrete. It all seems more diffuse. Everything's, the pores of everything open up, so to speak. And you can feel everything sort of shimmering, and you smell everything. It's emitting aromas, and wow. So maybe not going, being able to go down there means I'm going to be able to get it here, where I am right now. Probably it means that. So I was promised something in August. A breakthrough in August. It hasn't happened yet. So maybe this is the breakthrough. And this light, we're told, is around all form, whether we like the form or not, whether it's ugly, beautiful, we call it. It's every, the experience is that the commonality abstraction lives, you see. That's what's important. That abstraction is still alive. Nothing can kill it. So this light will be tinged in everything. Everything. No exception. And now we may be saying, oh wow, this is really heavy. Yeah, it is. This is why we have to practice the wow, because we have to do this. We have to get there. Nobody has a choice in this. So this is why I say this is a universal teaching here, is the shock and getting through the wow of it by sitting quietly and just accepting the fact that you're in shock. Just the acceptance and recognition of it. Then you say, well, what am I in shock about? And then you say, and become aware of the stupendous opportunity that you're presenting to yourself. And then, then there's awareness, and you feel centered in this awareness. I remember when I was young, I had this dream of this teacher, this guru in the world, some person who was just on fire with spiritual ecstasy or something, and they came to me, and I saw them, they came in, they were all on fire like this, and they drew this circle to me. They didn't say anything, they just drew a circle, and I looked at it and I said, huh. And then I put a point in the circle. I put a point there. I said, no, I said, that's what you're doing. What I'm doing is this. I put a point there, and what that did was that centered us. And what we need is centering in the wow as a way to get to true spiritual abstraction. And this teacher was more like a show off of how spiritual they were, sort of. It seemed that way, and didn't really, wasn't pragmatic enough in my estimation. Anyway, at least that's their way. My way would be to recognize the wow, that's the center. And then around the wow, you become aware, what is it, that the experience that is coming, I'm coming close to, what is that that I'm looking at? What is that I'm approaching? But staying centered in the wow, so you don't get lost in thinking and struggling. There's no, the struggle dies down. It's really tremendous. Is this really a universal teaching? And just full stop in the wow. It's like just sitting down in a chair. And say, oh my gosh, I'm really here. I'm really close here. I asked them, where's the first tee? And they said, off to the right there. Just go to the right. And you'll see it. I couldn't quite see where it was. Okay, I'll just go to the right and say, oh, you'll see it, no problem. Go to the right. Right-mindedness. We want to see people as discrete, concrete members of our family, members of our community, members of our tribe. You know, we want to try to get an identity. But when you see everything equally tinged with light, this reminds us of abstraction. And if we, and so special relationships, whether it be, you know, spouses, seven others, mother and children, father, children, whatever, you have to be able to see everyone as equally has this tinge of light around it, because the whole purpose of this is to remind us of abstraction and to help provide us a bridge out of this dream of concreteness. So this tree, you know, this yard, this house, and that one, everything shares a commonality, an absolute commonality of this tinge diffuse light. And the personality, the concreteness, cannot get that. It wants differences. It says, no, this is concretely different than that. That is concretely different than this. There's that. You know, that is that, and this is this. Well, in our practicing for abstraction, we say, yes, I am both this and not this. What is that? Abstraction. Meaning, I cannot be defined. So these practices that we're doing are designed to reassure us that we cannot be defined at all. Even the experience of abstraction doesn't define us. Now, can we share this with concreteness? No. It's not. An experience is not shareable, abstraction is not shareable with, in the form of concreteness. It would be like saying that sharing the experience of swimming in water, like a swimming pool, I'm swimming in a swimming pool, and then sharing that in the terms of a sculpture of concrete, of stone sculpture of water, and then the concrete people will be, look at that sculpture of water and say, oh, yeah, we understand what water is. Now we understand what swimming is. Sculpture of rock sculpture, a swimming pool, or someone in the swimming pool. They say, oh, now we get it, yeah. No, they don't. Concreteness can never get abstraction, can never understand it, can never experience it. So it is not possible to transfer such an experience to someone else. You have to experience it yourself. It cannot be put into an image, because whatever, you know, everything has this, you know, has this commonality of being tinged. Everything. How can you have an image of everything? How can you have this experience of a commonality of everything? How can that be put into a sculpture? You know, we could say it's work of art, and we need to, you know, but no, that's just trying to be intellectual. We cannot. So you cannot share such an experience with concreteness. It's not possible. And concreteness can never have such an experience. When you're having this experience, you're not experiencing concreteness. You're experiencing abstraction, and then recognizing that we've been pretending, you know, to be concrete. But we can see now it's a pretense. Now, Jesus tells us that this experience is the key experience, in terms of after that, you're really, really going to go very rapidly, and your freedom is assured. So we approach this experience, all of us are approaching it one way or the other. I've been trying to get it my entire life, since I lost it. I used to see light around everything when I was young. That's why I drew pictures. I showed, like, I put all these like wiggly rays coming out of everything. Like rays, you see pictures of saints with light coming out. That's how I saw everything. And gradually that, you know, disappeared. I think I hit my head real bad once, and it seemed to have stopped. And people said, oh good, you're normal now, you know. And I stopped drawing things that way, because they're really concerned. Like, why are you drawing stuff that way? That's not what you're seeing. You're just imagining. You're very imaginative. They said I was very imaginative because I put these rays of light around everything in my pictures. And they said, wow, Such an imagination. I said, what are you talking about? I'm just drawing exactly what I'm seeing. And they said, well, no, not really. You're confused between what you're seeing and your imagination. You're not able to divide the two. But that isn't true at all. That was literally what I saw. So I've been trying to get back to that and finding it extremely difficult. It's very difficult to pinpoint the reasons because there's so many of them. This world is dedicated to pretending to be dead. So the dedication runs extremely deep here. And is extraordinarily fanatical. This world is like a picture of fanaticism. So, you know, very few retain this, you know, seeing every light around everything. Very few. And those who lose it, you know, have a hard, difficult time getting back to it. But nevertheless, I feel I'm close. I've been building up this massive heat wave, you know, to get to it. And it may very well just move in. So way more important than trying to depict it in imagery or explain it is to focus on the wow, because nobody will get there unless they know how to manage the wow, manage their success. Nobody's going to get there unless they learn to manage their success. Certainly, it's possible to get a glimpse of it, but to actually abide in it, you have to manage it, the wow. So that's what's really important. All the rest of the stuff, you know, it can help. I mean, some of the pictures I put up, like the rippling water with Nicholas Roark's beautiful paintings and then reflected in rippling water, that kind of gives, you know, some little, you know, like push. It helps build up the momentum. So all these things I do help build momentum. But still, the key is the wow. So we have to have a clear mind once we go into this vision of light. We have to have settled, you know, be settled in this and say, okay, I'm full blast into this now. And so for me, the experience of first going there thinking, well, do I really belong here? You know, I have to settle that. The shock that I am welcome here. In fact, anyone would be. There isn't all the country club restrictions I thought might be there. I don't get questioned. There's nobody questioned me. They just said, oh, great. Yeah, sure. Here's the golf cart. Have fun. Enjoy. Anytime you want to go off. It's like that. Wow. So easy. So the sheer easiness of it is a drastic departure from what I expected. Therefore, here's the wow. When your expectations are not met, this produces a wow. And as we go towards truth, we expect all this difficulty and resistance, and it doesn't happen. And our expectations are like shocked. You might say, well, that's good, it was easy. But in our minds, we're geared up for extreme difficulty. And when it doesn't happen, you know, it's like we come undone almost. It's the wow arises in us. We're shocked. Our expectations are shocked. We have to be wise about this. Otherwise, I see no hope for anyone. For those who don't get wise to this, they're just spinning their wheels. And then they just hope that society changes enough to make them happy, which is never going to happen. Concrete society never changes enough. It remains concrete. It just shuffles the concreteness around. That's all. That will never satisfy us. So yeah, the spiritual path, you have to go fast. You cannot just sit back and wait for the world to come your way, so to speak. You know, your ship to come in. It doesn't happen that way. Vision doesn't happen that way. So you have to push towards it, and you're going to get the wow, the shock of the wow, as I have over and over and over and over and over again. So my mind is just processing this. Wow, there's no difficulty at all. And I keep wanting to see difficulty. I keep thinking, where is it? So you really have to get used to the fact there isn't any before you can really go out and have a vision. You have to realize, well, there isn't any difficulty to it. And this takes a while. It doesn't happen just immediately. The mind is just like reverberating with reconfiguration of expectations. It's just, I mean, this is, you know, basically we thought, well, we never can get to this, or it'll take forever, or only special people get to this, or so, you know, so you have to have some qualification, or for sure I can't do it. And all this stuff has built up a massive expectation for your future, you see? And then when you see that none of that's true, it's easy, then your mind has to change all its future expectations. So of course it's extraordinarily difficult. So anybody can talk a good game, okay, but actually getting there is where it's really at, and this for sure is going to cause massive disruption in our expectations, which is a huge wow. So I say, you know, the talkers are talking and the wowers are wowing. Now, as someone who's presenting this, I do both. But it needs, because it, highlighting emphasis is necessary for those who know. It's part of the responsibility. Those who know have a greater responsibility. But I try to keep, you know, my talk simple, and the wow is there. I mean, I'm feeling it very strongly right now. Sometimes it's so strong, I have to stop talking. Now, part of, now, there was no dynamic of, do you deserve it or earned it? Nothing there. It's just showing up. That's all you need to do, is just show up and decide you're going to do it. No qualifications are required, really. Nothing. I kept waiting for, you know, like my status to be questioned, and there was nothing. I wasn't trying to act like important or anything. I just wanted to find out. I mean, you know, who can play this golf course? And they never give me any indication that there's any, you know, requirements at all, qualifications of status-wise at all. Socially, you know, whatever, in any which way. It's simply those who want to. It's there. Wide open. Now, dualistic paganism always assumes that the rich have some special way, like in Egypt, the mummification and the inscriptions and all the stuff that they did was supposedly designed to enable immortality, the body, the soul to come back to the body and resurrect the body. And of course, those who weren't, you know, super rich couldn't do it. So, you know, they felt, well, it's not possible for us. And then they tried to devise some way, you know, around this. Modern times, same thing is in, for instance, the United States, over the last 60 years, actually, it's getting more than that now, isn't it? 65, 60 plus years. Same thing. I mean, they're you know, the WASPs, the upper class. I mean, there's a wealthy class of America, and jet setters. They seem to have access. And there's just an assumption among the poor, those who are not, you know, super wealthy, that there's something that they don't have access to, you know, that wealth would provide them. And this gets extended and generalized in our minds. And we really feel that we don't have access to this experience of light, that this is such a rarefied thing that you must cost like, wow, you have to be like some super high status, like the emperor, the president, you know. Ancient times, it might be the pharaoh, the emperor, now it's the president. You have to be really, so we struggle. We think, oh, I can never get there. So what happens? People take drugs is what happens. That's what happens. They say, well, I can't really have it, so I can, but let me have a fake experience like psychedelics, hallucinogens, etc. That's what they do. This is a sign you feel you're not worthy of the true experience of abstract light. You're not worthy of it. You have status, you have all these issues, and you're not working on the spiritual path, actually, of the wow. This is very true. In my long experience in this world, those who are taking drugs are in a big hurry. They feel like, oh yeah, well, we found a way to cheat the system. You know, we can just take the drugs. We can get a pretty good approximation of what our superiors get, and we'll call it good, like that. You know, and this is a huge problem. This is what I've been trying to help everyone with. Is there's no qualification for this. Like, I didn't see any whatsoever. Merely that I showed up and I requested that. I said, I want to play this course. That's it. I said, I decided I want to play this course this morning, so can you get me out? And he said, of course, yeah. Here's your card, anytime. No hurry, just anytime at all. And that's it. Well, who am I? See, this is important. Who am I in society? I have no status. This is important. Maybe I tried to do this, you know, by having no status, just to prove to everyone, because people just assume that the wealthy have some access to something that they don't. This is really a deep, deep, deep assumption. And having been on the other end of it in my previous life, where I literally hobnobbed and lived in vacation and spent time with the richest people in Europe. We call them now multi-billionaires. People assume that you're superior, you have some sort of access to something that is superior, that you're able to purchase, because you could purchase all the clothes, whatever you want, that makes you look, you know, like better. And so the assumption is completely permeated our expectations in this world, even in so-called equalitarian United States. It hasn't gone away at all, that the wealthy do have access to a better experience than we do. There's nothing we can do about it. So I wanted to say, no, that's not true at all. There's no everyone's inherently qualified by being created by God, by being spirit. So status has nothing to do with it, and people didn't believe me. You know, I realized the world absolutely did not believe me. So I said, okay, I'll prove it to you. I'll have no status here. I'll get the lowest status possible, basically, without being impractical about it. I don't have any money. I can't even pay right now to go play a round of golf. I have to have people help me to pay my bills. That's how bad my situation is. And my job is incredibly low status job. Just dealing with garbage. That's it. So I deal with garbage. I have no money. I have no friends. It's not like, you know, I can call up the Donald. Actually, I did, though, a couple days ago, didn't I? Cell phone was busy. But I don't have any friends. So I have no status. It's not like I can call up some rich friend and say, hey, you know, can we go to Hawaii or something? You know, no, I don't have any friends. So I have zero status in the world. And this is just to prove that this experience is open to everyone. Now, I don't want to prove the opposite either, that it's only open to those who have no status, because this is the way the ego will think, wait a minute, you know, that must mean you must have no status, and then people say, oh, I got to be a poor mendicant, you know, and no, that's not the point at all. That's completely missing the point. My point is that there's no status issue whatsoever. Makes no difference if you're a prince or a pauper. Both are equally accessible. This situation I saw is totally, all is showing up is all there is to it, and saying, I want this experience. That's it. It makes your status makes no difference at all. So maybe I don't have to keep this lowly status that I've been suffering from my whole life so terribly. This feeling of like, you know, I don't dare do anything wrong or make any mistake because I can't even afford a fine or a ticket or anything. I cannot live in, I live in dread of the world because I can't pay anything. It's really a horrible stress. But you don't earn the experience that way either. You see, the experience is not earnable. Let's put it this way. It's not earnable in any way. So maybe I don't have to keep this status. Maybe I can, you know, say, okay, that's enough. And finally be able to breathe a little bit, you know. And I can at least hope. But I can see a reason now why I would choose such a low status is because I want to bust this myth. You know, I want to be a myth buster. And this is the biggest myth there is in the world, really, is that, that somehow we don't have accessibility to this. And I'm saying that it's 100% accessibility. It's merely showing up and deciding you want this experience. That's all there is to it. Nothing more than that to it. And then age too, you know, getting older, and people say, well, it's only the young who can have this. You know, no. It's only middle age. No, you can have this even when you get older. Again, age has nothing to do with it either. Nothing has anything to do with it. No concrete attributes have anything to do with this. It is merely showing up and deciding, I want this experience. And they say, great, here's the golf cart. Anytime you want. You're free. You're free to go. You're free to tee off anytime you want. No, you know, it means you can sit for an hour before teeing off and just say, wow. Now, it's kind of weird for people because I appear to have such low status, you know, as far as work and everything, but I don't really act like a low status person in terms of my, you know, but I tried it, but it runs you down, so you feel like sort of hangdog, like a, but there are times when I, you know, it breaks through and I'm not, you know, obviously people say, wow, you know, what, this is odd, very odd. Someone told me that once. He says, this very bright guy, he says, this just doesn't fit. There's something weird going on here. You don't fit here at all, you know. You're not like anybody else that has this job. No way. You know, it's the prince and the pauper sort of thing. Is the prince decide to be a pauper just to prove, you know, really, was that Mark Twain's Prince and the Pauper, I think. This is what I've done. I wanted to experience myself and to prove status is not the issue. It's willingness. It's willingness to work on the wow. That's the issue. Anybody can do that. Garbage man, street sweeper, dog catcher, president, celebrity, professional, secretary, clerk, teacher, painter, construction worker, you name it, trust funder, capitalist, socialist, man, woman, child, old person, you know. There is no concrete attribute whatsoever that is required. No requirements except that you decide, I want to have this experience. And the status comes from saying, I want to have this experience. So when I walk, the status is walking in there and saying, I want this experience. That right there is the status. That's the feeling I had. By coming in there and requesting, I want to play this golf course. It was like, they were like, great. Wow, what a high status this this someone is, wow, this is great. You know, we don't get many we don't get many coming here to play this course. And so whoever comes here and says, I want to play this course, that's what gives you the status. And so getting out there on the course, you have the status then. I mean, you have this status of being there. And again, as I sort of peeked at the course, trying to get a feel for it, I was like, wow, this is different. I can't quite make heads or tails of this. What is this? But it looks beautiful. Wow. Looks like a great adventure. I'm about ready to take a great adventure here. Now, trying to help someone with this is quite difficult because the patience that's required is just off the charts. And people, when they go to someone for help, they expect some results. Cannot guarantee any results. I mean, I've been working on this my whole life. But what you can do is practice working on the wow. Because once you get skilled at that, you take that with you wherever you go. It's a skill you always have, and this skill that will translate into success. So trying to go out and make a bunch of money is not the right way to go. This is what's often told us by the great teachers. It's better to practice the wow, managing spiritual skills of managing this wow, and keep advancing your dedication of what you want. Keep advancing towards the experience you want, and then experience the wow of that, because it's this skill that results in getting what you really want. You can't purchase this. You can't purchase it. You know, you can purchase a sculpture, you can purchase things, sculptures, etc., but you can't, this experience, you cannot purchase it. You have to actually experience it. You can't purchase a concrete representation of it and get the experience at all out of that. You just will impress other knuckleheads, other concrete, to think, oh wow, look at that painting you got, that's really something. You know, you really have high status. But when you try to get money, you're not focusing on the wow, because the people who get money, they're quick, always trying to get advantage. They're this way. Working for such people, you find out this is the way they are. They're always looking for an edge, an advantage. They're always on that way. They're always trying to talk a better deal for themselves, make a better angle, make another shortcut. You know, how can I win? How can I succeed? How can I win? And in doing that, they never stop for the wow. They never stop for the wow. Because you might like do something successful, and then it's like, wow. And you just want to stop and just, you know, quietly for the rest of the day. Just, wow. Whereas those who want riches, you know, they'll just keep pushing, doubling down, pushing. Win, like that. So they don't prepare themselves for the experience. They only think that all they end up doing is buying some concrete symbol that they claim is important. They'll build some vast big temple or something, you know. Some seraphim. And they look at this great temple I've built. You know, well, you know, people say, oh gosh, you got such high status. Wow, it's amazing. And then the rest of people kind of feel like, well, I'm lesser than you. I can't really have the experience that you have. And so they sort of get this fake, you know, demagogic idolatry thing going, where they're not having the experience, but they're trying to convince others that they have. And this is terrible. That's why Jesus says it's harder for a rich man to get in the kingdom of heaven than the camel to go through an eye of a needle. If their consciousness is constantly focused on win, 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 never stopping for the wow, they cannot actually get into that experience. The wow will stop them. So if you're trying to, play the big shot, high status, like come walking in there, yeah, I'm high status. Okay, give me the cart, let's go. You know what'll happen? They'll get lost, or they say, wait, I need to go to my car, I can't quit. And they'll make excuses. I can't really get, something happened, and they'll never get out there. So what you do is you go in there and you just sit down and say, wow. Don't even jump right out. So obviously you're letting everyone know that this is like really shocking to you. You're accepted here. I can actually do this. That's why they told me anytime you want to go out, because they know if they said, well, we can get you off right now at 9:14, but you better hurry. Then I'll be all nervous and joke. Oh my gosh, But they didn't say that. They said, no, it's wide open. Anytime you want to go out, it's fine. Knowing that the right thing to do, they don't want to pressure me, but the right thing to do is sit and in the wow. Maybe sip some lemonade. Wow, comfort food. That's what I've been into. So it's like gathering your nerves. That's another way to put it. Gathering your nerves. Now, if you're used to faking status, you won't do this. You don't want anyone to see that you have a loss of nerve. This is what people run into. Those I've known have run into this problem very severely. Those who have been looked up to as gurus, as teachers, and idolized and worshipped as such. Some that I have known, actually. The whole thing was that people wanted to see that they never lost their nerve. And then people say, oh, wow, so I won't lose my nerve. They're not teaching properly then. Because the first thing they should be teaching those is that you're going to lose your nerve. Good. That means you're pushing forward. That's a great sign of progress. And so lose your nerve and then spend some time gathering your nerve in the wow. That you need to be skilled at regathering your nerve so you can take the next step. That's the whole point of the path. That's what it's all about. And so these people wanting to, appear to be these figureheads of humanity, they super high status, they can't afford to lose their nerve. Because everybody will abandon them then. That's what they're worried about. So they will try to just force things and push for it, and they won't be able to do it. They might start taking drugs. That happens. Some of these teachers end up start taking a lot of drugs. So they can seem to be in this exalted state. They don't want to, So we're just the opposite. We say losing your nerve like this, that's great. Not losing it, but having it, really needing to regather it. This is what it's all about. And of course, those in concreteness, wanting, thinking that the only way they can be satisfied is get more and more beautiful concrete things. If you're in a relationship with that, they'll pressure you into say, hey, I don't have time for you to lose your nerve. What are you doing? You get out there and earn more money and get me more things, right? This is the materiality of the times. So their pride won't let them go through the necessary steps. But here is very different. We applaud the wow. This is what it's, the wow is what it's all about. The wow is what it's all about. So we do take the time. This is why the videos are longer here. And it's not just some show of somebody on fire. It's also, I'm saying, wow, I'm really shaken up by this, and no question about it. I'm shaken to the core. And I know from the standpoint of those on the path, this is what happens. Our expectations are like a net. The landscape is our expectations. So it's the landscape of our expectations that shift and change so severely. And then just imagine if all the landscape suddenly rearranged itself in front of you, and you have to say, wow. This is why I put up those, pictures of Nicholas Roark and Jesus, and so it's a constantly shifting landscape. It's part of it. There's multiple reasons, but to be experienced shifting landscapes, oh, what's this? Oh, there's a different one. Oh, wow, there's a different one here, and a different one here, and a different one here. Wow, 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 wow. That's training. These are training tools to help us, get used to, get closer and closer and closer to the ultimate goal is this, seeing tinges of light around everything. And that's a commonality of abstraction. And somehow this calms our mind down, which is what we really want. And I don't try to figure out how it calms it down. We just have faith. It's reasonable to expect that it will. We don't know exactly. Dot, 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 dot. We don't have to. Just like you go out to some really beautiful place, you know it's going to have some effect on you. Just wow, like wow. It's going to leave a lasting impression. You don't know exactly how, or how long the impression will last or anything else. But you just know. You know that this is really something. This is a real precious memory, so to speak. But so here we're going towards something that is really, changes our destiny. I'm just imagining getting out on the course. What I do is I just drive the golf course cart real slow. I'd sit in it for a while and I just start going real slowly. No hurry at all. And then I say, I'm just going to take it real slow, to start out with. That's all. I'm not rushing to the first tee. I'm going like half a mile an hour at a snail's pace. You don't want to leave familiarity behind too fast. Just let it be a smooth segue, very smooth. So you don't panic. You don't want to panic. That's the worst thing. I used to go to a course long ago that was almost abandoned. Nobody played it. It was overrun, and was, a few people played it, but not many. And so I'd just go out and anytime by myself, and it had these huge trees everywhere, ancient trees. It was really something. And for me, I was like practicing going to the death-free realm or purgatory, as the Catholic Church calls it. But you're just walking among the trees. I always walk. I didn't. They have a golf cart there, and I couldn't afford it. We just walk. Just looking up at the trees, just walking below these huge trees. It's really quite wonderful. And finally, they shut it down. That's very regrettable. You can never play well there, but that's not the point. Because the greens are in terrible shape. Everything was. The rough was. Just lose your ball. It was just terrible. But it didn't matter. It's the experience of just walking among these huge trees, and there's nobody out there. In other words, you don't have to talk with anybody. No personal communications. No communications at the personality level. This is what's important. So can I get status by knowing a lot of stuff? No. Now maybe that's what I've done over the last week, is trying to get a whole bunch of information about the past, and so I know a lot about. But does that help me out? Not maybe in some way, but not as far as status goes. No. Doesn't. You know, it's the wow that has to be. I'm sure it helped in some way. You know, everything, if you do it with the right intention, is going to help in some way. So, the more abstract you can be in your landscapes, I've been trying to do videos, maybe I can do some more. Not a lot of people are watching them, but it's helpful, actually. Is to get used to more and more abstract, something that defies your expectations as far as the landscape goes, okay? Like, where am I now? Feel immersed in it. Put it on full screen. Where am I now? Whoa. I'm in a different place. Oh, no, I'm in a different place. I look at a different landscape. And we'll see what I can do. And maybe this will catch on, you know, at some point. I feel at some point people realize, hey, this is really possible. And these are some tools that I could use. But I think right now people are still saying, well, we'll wait and see. Which is perfectly understandable. Don't count your chickens before they're hatched. But on the same hand, bet on yourself, too. Invest in yourself. Bet on yourself. Say, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. Whether someone else does or not is not the point. I'm going to do it. So I need to keep practicing as abstract, you know, abstraction, shift of landscape. So, wow, I'm seeing things differently now. This is not what I expected to see. Wow, it's better than I expected to see. This is not what I expected to see. This is better than I expected to see. This is way better. And then I'm thinking like, wait a minute, maybe I have to pay at the end of the round, you know. And this is so wonderful, the price is going to be too expensive. But there's no fancy clubhouse at all, so I didn't see any amenities or anything that, you think that would be needed, you know, for payment. So, it's not like you could see, wow, there's a lot of money pumped into this. It didn't look like any money's been pumped into it at all, hardly. And the people working there didn't appear to be wealthy at all. They didn't seem to have any, snobbish status whatsoever. And again, you can't ask permission from the personality. Your personality will say, no, I don't want to go. If you say, hey, you got to come along with me, they'll say, no, I don't want to go. And you say, well, I can't go unless you go. And they say, well, I'm not going. And then you get into an argument. So you cannot, that's why I made the video last night. This is the real story, no punches pulled. And I made it very clear. It doesn't matter how beautiful the personality is or seems to be the forms that they're identifying as a personality. They're not going to go to this abstract experience, and asking them for permission is useless. They will say no for sure. So, but they won't argue with you if you just decide to go. You just park them somewhere, and go for the experience. And they'll be there when you come back. Personality will be there. And if they ask for explanation, well, it's both explainable and not explainable. What's the explainable part? Well, the explainable part is both the explainable part and not the explainable part. And then after a while, personality will just drop it, lose interest. So... So this is not a rambunctious path. You have to sit quietly. This is the basic discipline of what I've seen as a universal teaching, that the best way to evaporate the wow is to sit quietly. Don't make any moves. So if you're sitting in the lobby of this clubhouse and you're looking out in the course and there's the golf course right next to you, don't make any move. Just sit. You're not trying to go out and you're not trying to leave. Neither one. You're not thinking about going out. You're not thinking about leaving. You're not making any judgment about what you're going to do. Don't make any judgment about what your expectations are you're going to do. You're saying, what I'm doing now is I'm sitting right now. That's what I'm doing. And I'm only focused on what I'm actually doing right now, which is just sitting here. Big relief there. So I'd say when full stop in the wow, you say, I am just focused on the fact that I'm just sitting here quietly. That's all that I'm focused on. And I'm not trying to be the agent of change at all. I'm just like a reporter. I'm just aware. I'm just a witness to... I'm just... You hear some in throughout history, some say, be the witness. I'm just a reporter. I'm just witnessing. I'm just here. Sitting here. That's all. I'm not trying to witness it, so to speak, but you could use that term, but that can get turned around into thinking you're trying to do something. No, I'm just sitting here quietly. That's all I'm doing. I'm not trying to do anything else. So my mind is just kind of like in a sitting quiet mode and not really trying to do anything except just sit here, neither advancing nor retreating. put some hot sauce on some cold pizza this morning, but it's a mild hot sauce. And but after the pizza, the really burned. It burned for a long time. I said, "Wow, that's really strange. This hot sauce never gives that reaction, but it was way hotter than normal than I expected." And it's still, the after effects are still, you know, faintly there. But it's like, "Well, this is very odd." Well, this is like a wow. Like we see a glimpse of this abstraction, and we say, "Wow, this is way better than I expected. It's a little too." It's got some heat to it. In other words, it's like, it's a wow to it. And so you just need to kind of take it easy. Don't rush into it. Recalibrate your expectations. So this is this recalibrating of expectations at a deep, deep level. So as we're sitting here quietly, this allows us to recalibrate. This is an intentional recalibration. Whereas if we're doing things, this gets in the way. Throws a wrench into the recalibration. Because when we're doing things, we have expectations of our landscape, right? To be a certain way. Otherwise, we'd get panicky. We have expectations of our perceptions to be a certain way. Otherwise, we get panicked. We panic. Whereas we're sitting right here, we don't have any, it doesn't matter. I mean, it doesn't really matter if the world turns into a psychedelic, you know, fountain show or something. I'm just sitting here. I'd still be just sitting here. I'm not trying to move within that scenario. I'm not trying to do anything within that scenario. I'm not competing. I'm not striving. I'm not seeking within that scenario. So whatever it is, there's no seeking here. There's no trying to do anything. So let it be whatever it wants to be. Let it be. Whatever. It doesn't really matter. So this way then we can recalibrate. We're not nervous about it. Not so nervous about it. Recalibrating our expectations. Only then can you feel safe in recalibrating your expectations, because you're worried that in doing so, the experience might suddenly flame up upon you. It's like we're sparking and suddenly it bursts into flames. You might think, "Oh my gosh." So only by sitting here quietly will we have the confidence to recalibrate, because we're a little nervous that it might trigger something. But for me, it's never triggered anything. Recalibrating has never triggered anything. But the fear that it might is certainly there. Therefore, we want to be sitting quietly and feel in our body no motivation or impulse to act at all. We must surrender the impulse to act when we're doing this practice, this universal practice, walking together. Wow, it is a universal practice teaching here. Surrender the impulse to act for a while. Repent. This is repentance. Surrender the impulse to act. And then we can recalibrate our expectations. Now, on a real hot day, it's easy to surrender the impulse to act. It's easier. You feel like, "Yeah, I just want to sit here. I don't want to do anything." So it's helpful. Heat is helpful, whereas it's more temperate climate. You think, "Wow, I want to go out and run. I want to do something." That it feel more like impulse to action. But real hot, no, you'd rather just sit in the shade. You say, "I'm not moving. I don't want to move. I don't want to move at all." A lot of teachers, spiritual teachers, have come from India, southern India. Various India gets real hot, and a lot of, you know, there's a lot of the times it gets real hot, and you just want to sit. You don't want to move. Of course, they didn't have air conditioning or anything. So, great opportunity to make spiritual progress. A lot of the desert fathers, a lot of those who were seen as saints, came out of the desert areas, hot areas. Find a cool, some cool shade, some water. Don't move. Well, it's 120 outside, just don't move the whole day. Surrender your impulse to action. And therefore, you could really work on recalibrating your expectations. Keep in mind, like the healing of in the past, was the healing that Jesus said your faith made you whole. People in the past, not having the kind of medicine we have now, they felt that the only way that they're going to be healed is through a miracle, that they're going to be miraculously healed by appealing to some god, deity, saint, whatever, somehow, some ritual, whatever. And so they had absolute belief in the efficacy of this. So if some charismatic person, you know, spiritual persons, you know, says, absolutely, you're healed. You've come to me, and I heal you in the name of this and that. The person will say, oh, this is going to work for sure. There's no doubt in my mind that this is what's going to cure the illness. There aren't any other options. So oftentimes they'd be healed. And I always wonder, why is this not happening so much now? It happened after World War II. I mean, William Brennan, there was a lot of healing. Maybe the people relapse, that often happens, but tremendous amount of Pentecostal evangelical healing after World War II for several decades. But now in this climate, we have a pharmaceutical climate of medicine and surgery and all this modalities of treatment. Nobody really expects to be healed through laying on of hands or someone just saying, get up and walk, you know, their expectations aren't there at all, and so it blocks it. Whereas in the past, that all their expectations were there. They said, oh yeah, if I go to this place, this holy place, and sacrifice this and do this, I'm going to be healed. This is what you do to be healed. So they absolutely expected to be healed. And so it's a piece of cake in that mindset for some authoritative person. All it takes is some authoritative person to say, yeah, it's okay that you be healed. I won't be upset with you. You know, it's not against the law to be healed. So don't, yeah, it's, so then they say, okay, great. So they need somebody just to provide that final, you know, assurance that you won't be persecuted for being healed. Be assured you will not be persecuted for being healed. Oh, great. Okay, I can let go of this illness. And they're healed. Whereas today, the whole mindset is nobody can let go of an illness. You have to go to the medicals through the medical establishment in order to get rid of an illness. This is basically the law. There's nobody standing up and saying you can just set an illness aside like that. In fact, they've really criminalized it. Maybe they'll criminalize you for fraud, saying you never had it in the first place, and all the money you got, like if you're disabled and you were just healed miraculously, they'd insist that you were a fraud, and that they would sue you and put you in jail, saying you collected all the disability money under false pretenses. So, you know, as far as like healing goes, I don't think people should expect that, really. I don't think we should expect the Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit, to be the same as they were back then, because extremely different set of expectations. And we have this massive, massive, powerful authority, pharmaceutical industry, and the medical establishment basically running everything, running the show of our culture. And they've made it very clear that they do not accept any sort of just faith healing at all. So, the idea that somehow we're supposed to match up with the old saints is ridiculous. Okay, it's ridiculous. Anyone who thinks that way has not really looked in any depth at all, has not given the Holy Spirit a chance. The miracles that happened in the past were because of the expectations of the people. And there's just somebody that said, sure, let it be done. Is that your will? You want to be healed? Then fine. That's not against the law. Perfectly acceptable. And they say, oh, thank you. You healed me. Such a blessing. Jesus said, no, you healed yourself. I just was an authority that said, sure. Basically said, God's not going to be mad at you. Jesus was speaking for God, would just say, sure. God says that's wonderful. Now, you understand that religion has always been a money-making business. And so, I remember there's some saint that, I think it was Saint Paul. What was it, Philippi? What was his third journey, maybe? There's somebody there with, a soothsayer, somebody, a diviner, a soothsayer, and Paul healed them of that. He healed them of some illness or something, and by doing so, they weren't able to be a soothsayer anymore. And then they got really mad and said, I can't make any money. I made my living by soothsaying. And then the people of the town got stirred up so angry at him that Paul had to flee for his life. And this is not uncommon, that healing gets people angry at you because somehow the healing is serving some purpose. That, like, for this instance, it was money. So there was a lot of competition. So they said, you got to go to this shrine. You got to go to the Oracle of Delphi. You have to go to this shrine or this place. Or Seraphis, you have to pay the price here and sacrifice and pay the priests and everything, and then you'll get your healing. Where the Christians were going around just missionaries saying, just be healed, be healed, be healed. And they said, whoa. This is interfering with our revenue stream. You can't have people coming to you. So it's a business. Healing has always been a big, big business. Always. Probably the biggest business there's ever been. It's always been healing from sickness. And so if you just go around healing people, if someone just walked into a hospital and just went and just healed everybody and everybody just walked out of the hospital, well, you don't think that would cause an absolute firestorm of legal lawsuits, etc.? Keep in mind that a lot of the relatives of people in hospitals can't wait for them to die because they're going to get the inheritance. Keep in mind that there are a lot of spouses that can't wait for their elder spouse to go into a rest home, assisted living, and get the heck out of their lives as fast as possible. Keep in mind that there are a lot of caregivers who can't wait for some troublesome patients to die and help them along by over-medicating them. Okay. And the relatives, who very rarely visit, turn the other way. They don't care. They say, the sooner they're dead, the more I get their money. This goes for, both sides of the coin here, for sure. So, you go into a assisted living place, and you take pity and just say, stand up, you're healed, get up out of your bed, you're healed, you're all healed. And they all just walk out of there. Well, first of all, they can't walk out of there because it's gated. And the police they call the police and they'd be returned to the bed. You have to be certified that you're well by a doctor. A doctor is never going to certify that you're well. They're prescribing all sorts of medicine to these people. So we have just this massive resistance to healing right now, to spiritual healing. And yet the ego is saying, well, if you want to be a saint, modern day saint, you have to do what the older saints did. You have to heal everybody, everybody you meet, heal, 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 heal. No, you can have an army of lawyers after you if you do that. Everyone's going to hate you. You don't want your death, actually. Maybe that's why they crucified Jesus was a medical establishment, which was really all these other religions were the medical establishment back then. Said, we can't have this guy and his apostles just wandering into our towns and healing everybody they come across. That's how we get rich. They're taking our business. So, absolutely. I mean, the Sanhedrin was the, a lot of them were the ones that the Sadducees who presided over the sacrifices, I believe, from the tribe of Levi, and this is how they made their income. This is how they got rich. This is, you know, they were rich. Millions of people coming to Jerusalem to the temple sacrifice to try to, well, they had it both ways, is both to get well from an illness and to proactively prevent any future illness. You see, so they had it both ways. This is interesting, isn't it? It's like the house, gambling house, that they put a vigorish on you, on your bets. No matter who you bet for, they still get a percentage. Bet this way, you get a percentage. Bet that way, they get a percentage. So the medical establishment of that time, being these priests, priestly class, and their families and clans, of course, and wives and children, everyone who benefited from this. They don't want anybody wandering through Jerusalem healing everybody for free. You kidding? Of course they're going to drum up some death sentence against someone like that. That was the medical establishment of the time, and people came there to be healed and to gain merit so they wouldn't have any future illness. So they, it's like life insurance, pay, and we'll make sacrifice, and then you'll gain all this merit with God, and therefore when you get old and stuff, you won't suffer such these illnesses and these problems, etc. You'll have a wonderful, good life. People say, oh, great. So it's like going to a doctor and saying, Doc, you know, I'm really healthy now, but I want to stay that way, you know. What can I do? And the doctor says, you know, just take these medicines and that'll keep you healthy. And say, oh, thank you, Doc. It's like that. It's exactly what it was and has been throughout history. Preventative. What do you think the church is doing? Catholic Church. Sure, they say, you know, you'll get into heaven, you die in a state of grace. They say, no, you can't get into purgatory unless you die in a state of grace, and you have to be purified in purgatory before you go, you know, to the kingdom of heaven. And they have the only way to get into purgatory. Great business, right? The only way. And then, but also while you're there, the prayers for the sick, and then prayers for the dead, and so you'll be sure that you'll have prayers to help you through purgatory, and that, you know, you're getting merit as you go to church, which is to help you from getting sick and suffering during this life. I mean, it's a whole medical business. It is the medical establishment. It has been for the last, you know, couple thousand years. That has been the medical establishment of the world. Now we have a different one, the pharmaceutical industry, PC culture, pharmaceutical culture. And, you know, they want to take over from all the religions and they want to monopolize it. Because as we said, I said that, you know, like for instance, the Pentecostal movement after World War II, they've always been into healing. They were just, you know, totally into healing. I mean, the barnstorming throughout the country, throughout maybe the world. They go to all over the world, and these evangelicals hold these huge rallies. There's 100,000 people and more that come. And what are they there for? Healing plus merit, acquired merit. And the priest or the healer is the one who transfers the merit to the people, supposedly. And the merit of God, they say the merit of Jesus Christ, that is unlimited merit with God. So all you have to do is ask that merit to be transferred to you through the healing mission. And then, of course, then there's always the concern of keeping the merit. And so buy this, you know, this, da, 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 da. It's a business. It's the biggest business in the world. Health. Jesus is a very, the story is a very interesting placebo, actually. It says, don't worry. All the anger of God that should be poured out upon you in the form of illnesses and afflictions was poured out on Jesus instead. And therefore, magically, somehow, however they want to put it, so it's as a powerful placebo effect, that if you accept that this happened, then you realize you don't the wrath of God will not be poured out upon you. It was poured upon Jesus. It's just a, you know, it's just a placebo. Makes no sense at all, really. It's a placebo. I mean, God doesn't have anything to do with this at all. God is perfect. There's no wrath on God. You know, it's absolutely divorced from reality, 100%. But it's the placebo effect, powerful placebo effect on some people. Which really means they have permission, that God won't be angry at them. Because God's already been angry at Jesus. All of God's wrath is trained on Jesus. It's a displacement sort of thing. Like, hey, if I get well, like, you know, just like decide to not be sick anymore, we feel God could be really angry at me because, God, of course, we think God wants us to die and suffer for our sins. So, but they say, wait a minute, but God is so focused his wrath on Jesus that he's forgotten about all of us. So I can go ahead and do it. It's safe to do it. I don't like that. You know, that's pretty much what it's like. Somehow it strikes a chord in people. And then they get well for a while. And of course, till the next illness comes. Yeah. And they, what did I do? I backslid. I need to donate more to the church. Of course, if you get well, you feel like, I need to donate a lot of money to this church. Maybe that'll keep me well. And maybe that's merit. They kind of, that sort of tacitly, you know, there's that whole feeling of accumulating merit, which will forestall future problems. And that the wrath of God somehow became exhausted upon Jesus. And God is now in this, you know, state where he can't generate any more wrath. And so he poured it all out on Jesus because Jesus dared to not be sick, you know. And that how, so God is absolutely furious with Jesus. He says, no, you're supposed to come here to die. And you didn't want to do that. Oh, my God. So all of God's wrath is on Jesus. And then we can say, it's not on us. So we can get well. So it works wonders. I mean, placebo effect works wonders if you believe in it. Now, I can't believe in that because I know it's just made up as far as the formulas that they're using. Not that the Jesus story was made up necessarily. It could have been, but maybe it wasn't. We'll find out eventually. But the placebo thing is made up out of thin air. It's just something that psychologically, it's effective psychologically, because we think we're supposed to die. We came here, spirit, this is a representation of spirit trying to die. And that this imaginary God of guilt that we made is supposed to, whose only existence depends on our imagination as being this judge of judging our death. If we start not dying, we imagine that this God that we invented, this God of guilt, is going to be furious with us, absolutely furious with us. So I say, how do we deal with this? I say, oh, well, this God is so furious with Jesus, he doesn't have any more fury left over for me. It's been quite effective throughout history. But we can do better than that. We can do better. So, I mean, you don't argue with effectiveness. I mean, the placebos, it's not like I'm against placebos. I mean, Jesus actually says that all medicines are placebos. All medical thing procedures, everything is a mere placebo. That's it. So, no, you don't argue with success. But the success is limited. So at some point, you need to go to true success, which is a different story here. And this is what we're doing here. This is setting down all infirmity, all death, everything, and realizing that we invented this angry, jealous, insecure God. This Jehovah God, we invented it as having the capability to judge that we're dead. See, how can we judge we're dead if we're dead, if we're actually authentically dead? How can we judge? How can we know the fact? We can't. We couldn't. So we said, well, we have to be authentically dead before we can prove that we're greater than God and be greater than God. So we have to have this judge, this judging God, this judge, we call it God, but it's really this God of judgment, we call it. That's what Jehovah is, a God of judgment. We invented this in our minds. We just made it up. And we say this God of judgment is able to discern that we're actually dead, authentically dead, spiritually dead. at which point then we'll be resurrected, magically be resurrected from this judgment, we'll be resurrected. But so when we start to decide, wait a minute, I don't really want to be authentically dead, you know, then we feel like the need for this God is not so much. And then we imagine this God is getting really angry and furious at us, like, well, you're trying to kill me, you're trying to kill me, you're trying to get rid of me. Which is partially true. I mean, we're saying, I don't need this imaginary God to judge my death because I can't die. But we don't, not being clear about this, we feel this anxiety. Where's this coming from? Oh, God's angry with me. God's angry with me. And then, you know, what do I do with this anger? This is horrible. And then we get this placebo, like, oh, God's not angry at me. God's angry at Jesus because Jesus refused to die at all. He refused to be sick. He said, I can't be touched. And we say, God's really saying, hey, it's like displacement. Hey, God, don't be angry with me. Look at Jesus. He's way worse than I am. You know, I'm just trying to get rid of this leprosy. I mean, Jesus, he refuses to be sick at all. Now, that's absolute blasphemy, God. So, you know, I'm not your target. Jesus is the target. Go get him. And then, you know, the idea of Jesus, the passion, being tortured and flayed and crown of thorns and crucified. You know, this is symbolic of God just furious, venting all his fury on Jesus. And we say, oh, good, God bypassed me, you know, the Passover, bypassed me and spent, got all his wrath onto Jesus. So maybe I can get well, but we're still kind of insecure about it, right? We try to convince ourselves, well, now this God's a God of love because he's exhausted his wrath. But this is just, again, the God of judgment is an imaginary judge we have simply invented. We made it up as the only means we could think of as a scam and a scheme and a plan. So because we said, well, the only way to be greater than God is to kill God. But if we kill God, we end up killing ourselves too because we're one with God. So how do we then experience being greater than God? And they said, well, if we're dead, we won't know we're dead. But maybe we can invent some other God that can judge that we are dead and say, okay, now I know that you are indeed dead, and somehow communicate that to us and bring us back from the dead, you see, or resurrect from the dead. And then we will say, oh, yeah, I did die, and that means God, my will is greater than God. I killed God, and now I'm alive once more means I am the one and only prime creator. There's no competition. God's gone. I'm the new prime creator. This is our scheme, but we end up with this insecurity, and so we figure we'll use this placebo of Jesus receiving all of this imaginary God's insecurity, which is total, unending, you know. Just, they said that Jesus was punished for both God's wrath for the sins that we have committed and for the sins that we will commit. This is a very important part of this placebo effect. Now, again, I don't want to take this placebo effect away from anybody that finds it useful for them. So it's not that at all. I'm just saying I want something better, because this really doesn't free us from, it doesn't really result in us getting what we really want at all. It might ease off some illnesses, sure, absolutely. No question about it, but we're still going to die. We're still going to get old. We're still going to suffer insecurities. I mean, we're still going to suffer. So I don't want that. I want true freedom, true bliss, true happiness right now. And to do that, you have to recognize, see through the whole thing, that this has all just been a scam, a ridiculous scam that we've dreamed up. There's no wrath from the true God at all, and this fake God is. We don't have to see it wrathful. We can just realize we simply don't need it. Just set it down. Gently set it down. Exchange. We don't have to believe in any placebo effect, actually. So people say, well, how did you get healed? What kind of placebo effect did you use? How did you get rid of the wrath of God? You say, I realize that this God of judgment is my own imagination, based on my arrogance of trying to be greater than God. So I set my arrogance down, exchanged pretending to be dead, pretending to be alive, eternally alive. And that's what I did. And most people won't understand that. They say, I don't understand. I need the placebo effect. No, this is different. We're not talking about a placebo effect here. It's very different. So whatever happened in Jesus' life is what happened. But it doesn't change the facts. It doesn't change anything at all in terms of what we need to do. There's no miraculous intercession. There's no appeasement of a wrathful God. There's none of that. You know, that's all placebo effect. You know, this either it happened or it didn't happen, but it has no bearing on us actually being truly saved at all. That's not true salvation, this placebo effect. Now, we keep thinking we can make the placebo effect so powerful that it'll be true salvation, but it won't, because we're still believing that we have to trick something, you see, and that something's being tricked, and that there is a God of wrath and judgment. And it's not, it's something external to us, and this is absolutely not true. The belief there's anything external to us. You see, in order to believe that there can be some judge of our death, we have to believe that there's something external to our mind, because our death would be the death of the mind. So how can there be a judge of our authentic death if there's nothing external to our mind? It's impossible, right? So we have to believe that this judge, God of judgment, is external to our mind. And then how do we solve that problem? That there's something still there, right? If we even if we use a placebo effect, we're still believing there's something external to our mind, which is not salvation at all. All the problems are still there, you know, no matter how much temporary relief we seem to get from them. It's not like we can say, well, Jesus, you know, exhausted the wrath of this external God to our mind. Because how did that question still remains? Well, how did something get external to our mind? How's that possible? How can we accept the true God, which says there's nothing external to your mind? We'd have to say, well, you're a liar. I know there is. There's God of judgment, but Jesus, you know, cured this God of his wrath. And you can't get in the kingdom of heaven that way. The kingdom of heaven is a realization there's nothing external to our experiencing, to our mind, to our spirit. It's impossible. So we've got to go beyond placebo effect here, which is what we're doing. But again, we're respecting those who do still using placebo effect. Sure, why not? If that's what they want to do. I mean, that's the best they can do where they're at right now. Why should we? We're not standing in the way of that at all. We're not standing in the way of the medical establishment at all. If that's, you know, most people have been trained that this is what they have to do. And so this is what they will do. Fine. Eventually they'll have to be retrained, yes, they'll have to retrain their mind, as we have done. And eventually they will, but it may be, you know, who knows when what will happen. Hopefully sooner rather than later, but we're not going to hold our breath about that. Yeah, it's heating up a little bit now. So we're motoring right along here. This is the kind of progress that we would expect. This is a flipping the script part of our practicing, by the way, as you probably know. As we're sort of talking and showing, you know, what's the theory behind the flipping of the script that we're doing. Assertions would be, yes, I can. Yes, I'm already seeing edges of light. Yes, I can see edges of light. Yes, I will see edges of light. Yes, I am seeing edges of light. Abstraction is my true identity. Abstraction is the true identity of all. These would be like assertions. Now, assertions can produce a very powerful wow, so sometimes we go easy on them. So again, don't think that you have to do miracles, cast out demons. I mean, the psychiatrist say, no, that's our job. We're not going to let you do that. Veterinarians will say, no. You can't heal that pet. That's our job. We're going to make like thousands of dollars working on that, your pet, and thousands more. I mean, I know people, they spend a fortune on their animals, a fortune. They spend more money on the medical care of their animals than they do people, by far and away. Of course, because animals have a much shorter lifespan, and they have all sorts of problems. They drop 4,000 here, 6,000 here, 10,000 here. I mean, surgeries and recoveries and medications and doctor's visits and on and on and on and on and on. They'd spend a fortune. So you can't just go heal. You know. Heal the dog, heal the cat, heal the pet. No. You'll bring down the wrath of the world upon you, for sure. So I believe this is something that people are really frightened about subconsciously, you know. So I can't stand an example of going around healing, healing, healing. That'll freak everybody out. People say, wow, you'll get us into hideous trouble, you know. So pretty much set example of not healing in terms of that kind of thing. Sitting quietly and silently. Don't threaten the establishment in this way. The establishment now is ferocious. It's got a million fangs everywhere. Million lawyers everywhere. You know, you can't stand outside of a veterinarian clinic and heal every animal that comes to you and feel sorry. People, I'm so sorry, my pet, my cat's dying. Can you please do something? And, oh yeah, be healed, cat, and the cat gets well. And the veterinarian is, you know, you're just taking all their potential income. And their vacations are disappearing. Their new car, their new home, their new clothes, their remodeled kitchen. Okay. Their retirement fund. You know, they retire, you know, when they're 50 or whatever. I mean, they're building up a retirement fund, all this stuff. Their investments for retirement. The good life that they expect to live. You're taking all that away from them. You think they're going to stand for that? You know what? That's why Jesus said, keep this miracle to yourself. Didn't he not say that a lot? He said, okay, be healed, but don't tell anybody. You're healed of blindness. Don't go tell anyone. Okay. But of course they said, well, how'd you get your blindness restored? How'd you get your blindness restored? And some say, well, you're never blind. You were never blind. You know, they couldn't believe it. They said, no. We can't have anyone healing. So Jesus did often, you know, do the healing on the down low. And said, don't tell anybody what happened, please. This is going to cause me troubles. Cause you troubles, me troubles too. So it's way better to focus on the spiritual path than to worry about healing. You know, it's possible to send something in remission, sort of, you know. Yeah. And as long as you keep going to your doctor for checkups and stuff, maybe they won't get them too angry. Physical therapy, you know, you got to be very careful about this whole issue. Of course you want to heal people to be healed. But you know what? If they start focusing on the wow, they'll find out that their illness is just an expression of the wow that's not being paid attention to. All boils down to money here, doesn't it? So, what we're saying is just focus on the wow. Everybody focus on the wow. Connect with that. And as soon as you connect with that, you'll feel that there's a path for you. You'll become aware of the context. And say, oh my gosh, there really is a path for me. And then you're not so frightened about illnesses and troubles. Because you feel like, you know, those will kind of fade away as I burn off this wow more and more. Those illnesses will just kind of fade away. That's been my experience. There's constant battle among various medical treatments, isn't there? The vitamin people, the chiropractors battling medical establishment. The newest one is neuropathy. You know, they're trying to get everybody to sign up for that and all these treatments. And the first thing you ask them is, well, is this covered by insurance? They don't tell you. They say, well, we'll go over that. They get you in and they have an appointment. And they say, well, we'll take a look at that. You know, we have to evaluate. They say, first we have to evaluate your situation. No, they don't. You get in there, they evaluate your situation, and they say, well, you know, this isn't covered by, this treatment's not covered by medical insurance, no. But by then you're in there, they're telling you, you know, doing all these tests, telling you here's the treatment and everything. And there's all these people getting, you know, treatment for neuropathy, which, you know, if it works, that's great. But it's a money-making thing, no question about it. They're in business to make as much money as possible. And they don't tell you up front that it's not covered by insurance. Of course they're not going to say that. So, and then medical establishment is, of course, you know, the chiropractor's medical establishment. The medical establishment doesn't want any treatment the chiropractors give covered by insurance, so that, of course, people will then won't go to them. They'll go to the doctors, and the doctors will charge the insurance companies for the massive, you know, not massive fee, but whatever fee the doctors get. Hospitals charge huge fees. Hospital administrators, I mean, there's so much money. If it's the pharmaceutical companies, ultimately make out like bandits. It's a completely sick system. The entire system is utterly sick, which is what Jesus was pointed out. But it's a million times worse now than it's ever been. So you cannot expect someone to just go around healing everybody. I don't know. Maybe there's such little time right left now. Maybe. Then maybe what the heck, you know. They'll throw you. Back then they threw you in jail. They'd just trump up some charge and throw you in jail, plain and simple. Right now, all you have to do is some accuser just accuse you of something, and they'll jail you. Pharmaceuticals, someone will say, hey, look. They'll bribe somebody. They'll just say, hey, look, we'll give you $100,000. Just say that this such and such, you know, abused you or did, you know, something that's illegal, that get them thrown in jail and whatever. And then people will just make up something. It's that simple. And a homeless person will say, here's $100,000. Just say that person, you know, abused you or something. And they say, wow, no problem. I got nothing to lose. Just like criminal gangs use homeless people now. And they do the work, and the masterminds are far from the situation. And if the homeless people get caught, what happens? They get put in jail? Well, they get free food and board. You know, so what do they have to lose? So if you're wondering, where are all the saints? Well, just look at this dynamic that's present right now. Where are all the healers? People going around, heal, be healed, be healed, be healed. Usually they have to go to other countries where the medical establishment is not so viciously entrenched. You go to Africa somewhere and people line up and, you know, heal, 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 heal. And a lot of people get healed. Absolutely. Everything is just a mental construct. So any mental construct can be changed. You're paralyzed, you can get right out of the chair and walk. That's easy. Anyone can do that. Any illness can be instantly healed. Just decide you don't need it anymore. You don't want it, you don't need it. It's not really serving a purpose for you anymore. And it's gone with the wind. But, you know, so, yeah, it's mostly in other countries. United States, boy, they have clamped down on this big time. Very interesting. Wow. So the situations you see in the world, they don't have anything to do with feeling like the non-dual teachings that somehow are able to move forward a little bit. They never get into healing at all. And they say, we're not dispensing any therapeutic advice whatsoever. They have to, otherwise they get sued. Keep in mind, America is awash in excess lawyers, desperate to line their pockets, to sue any, they'll sue anybody that they can. They're desperate to sue someone. The litigation lawyers, I'm not talking about the business, I'm not talking about the better brand of lawyers who make an honest living from negotiating and resolving, you know, stuff. But I'm talking about the litigation ones. They're simply, you know, who can I get money from? Who can I sue? Practicing medicine without a license, you know, and then, you know, someone gets worse again. They say, well, you know, offering false hope. I mean, personal injury stuff, you know, whatever. Of course, if doctors treat you for a while, you get a little better, then remission like cancer, they don't get sued. You know, they've completely rigged. Medical establishment has absolutely rigged the entire legal system. The ancient people are actually better off spiritually because at least they could recognize it's on their mind. You know, okay, faith healing. Faith healing is better healing. Because at least you realize that there's some spiritual dynamic involved in what you're experiencing. Whereas right now, you know, this is a dead end. What we're in right now is a very bad dead end. Of course, everybody that comes, if you're a spiritual teacher, everybody that comes to you wants some healing of some sort. Almost. That wouldn't be on my mind, really. You know, it's probably in the back of everyone's mind, but I would say no. You know, whatever I'm suffering is because of my own, you know, still the wow complex is still there, and I just have to keep evaporating that, so that's what I need help with. If I just keep doing that, I know I'll have no afflictions whatsoever. Forever, I'll be completely free of any afflictions, so I'm going to ask for help to evaporate in a wow. And just, you know, put up with whatever suffering you have. Everybody's got a sob story. Everybody. Everybody. Somewhere they've got a sob story. And you can't spend your teacher time listening to all these sob stories. So it has to be very clearly delineated. We're just here full stop in the wow. You know, save your sob stories. This is not what it's for. Because you're about to experience something that will take all affliction away from you forever. And you've got to get ready for that. Don't spend all your time and effort battling. I mean, people battle with a skin condition. I got a blemish on my skin, you know. They're obsessed. Their whole persona is obsessed by it. And I can't do anything until I get rid of that, you know. For me, for example, I never pay attention to what the condition of my body is, really. Scratches, bruises, this and that. I never even look at it. See, you know, someone else will point out, oh, look, we got that bruise. I say, huh? But I never even look at it. If I glance, I say, oh, you know, forget it. Whatever. Condition of my skin, condition of this, condition of that. The only thing I do is my hair, you know, to comb my hair. You know, you don't want to look completely disheveled. It scares people. So, you know, I try to look neat and presentable. But other than that, don't pay attention to the body. Even when I got some problem, I just shrug and say, well, you know, that'll go away too at some point. So just thank it for being here for whatever reason. You know, it's an expression of a wow that I haven't looked at. And it will dissolve at some point. Just keep on practicing. I don't go in for tests. I don't go to doctors for tests. People keep saying, you need to be tested. I said, why? I'm not going to do anything about it. Whatever's there, it's a mental construct, and I have to dissolve the wow. So just same old, same old. So it's just a waste of time and attention. Don't take any medications. You know, brush my teeth, take shower, brush my teeth. That's it. So, everybody, yeah, look presentable, that's fine. I find that just makes life easier, you know. People don't look at you like, kind of, that guy's kind of dangerous or something. She looks kind of scary, you know. No, just look neat, presentable. People say, okay, he's one of us, you know. But don't worry about what does the body look like? How's it look? How's it, you know, what is this? Don't pay too much attention. Now, of course, if something gets your attention, you know, enough, obviously. This is not medical advice. This is just spiritual advice as far as your attention goes. Don't give too much attention to the body. The tendency is for people to give way too much attention to the body, to obsess about it. Of course, this, you know, ruins the spiritual path. They cannot take it when it's like that. So, of course, if you've got a severe toothache, you see the dentist. You know, if you've got a medical problem, see a doctor. For me, my faith is such that I feel, for me, because I practice so intensely, I feel that it will dissolve, you know, through this practice. But I'm not giving this as advice to others, because, you know, you get sued if you give any advice to anybody, period. It's up to each individual to determine, really, you know, what they do with their body. Nobody can, you know, nobody's responsible for our body except us, really. And parents with children, so they say. But even then, ultimately, the spirit is still entirely presenting the child, 100%. Now, oftentimes we do get stuck. I was talking about this pride factor of some teachers who go far along, but then they say, I can't show loss of nerve, so I just can't do that. They get stuck. Then they can get some severe illness and die from it, and they refuse to get to treatment from it. This is a problem. So if you're stuck through excess of pride, then you need to get some sort of treatment, whatever the modality of the times is. Ancient times would be faith healing. These days it's, you know, medical treatment. So, yeah. But at the same hand, work to get unstuck. Work to get unstuck. So my pride almost cost me my life once. You know, I had a infected tooth, and it infection spread throughout my whole body. I kept saying, well, this will pass, this will go away, this will go away. And it didn't. And I was in bad, bad shape. Just caught at the nick of time. But I really felt it would go away, but it didn't. So there are, you know, residual complexes that come up of continuity fear and pride and arrogance and wow, that's so strong. But at that time, I wasn't really aware of the wow practice. Maybe just subconsciously. So now, you know, it's possible to have much stronger release from being stuck. We can really get ourselves unstuck. Of course, when we do that, we go into the next step where we get stuck again, and then we release ourselves. So it's a matter of releasing ourselves from these blocks or stuckness, which we have to do through humility. Is again, if you approach the path with pride, you can't do it. Because the whole thing with humility is, I'm going to become undone. My nerve is going to be wowed out, you know, and I just got to sit here like I can't even do anything. I don't feel like responding to anything. I got to regather my nerve here. I've been really shocked. This is humility. So humility is the key to success, really, which is what's been taught throughout history. People can debunk everything they want, but throughout history there's been great teaching. So, you know, who cares what labels attached to it? Ultimately, it's the effectiveness and the teaching that's important. And humility is so important. And conscious understanding of this wow factor, that you lose your nerve temporarily. And you say, okay, temporarily I've lost my nerve here, because the entire landscape of my expectations are being rearranged. So it's like, I don't know what to do. I feel if I try to do something, it's way a panic. So I'm just sitting here. Wow. This is humility. This is what's required. Humility wins. It's heating up now a lot more. This is really, I can feel the mugginess on my face. This is something that's just pushing into the area. This is quite extraordinary. Because yesterday was cool. It was just, and last night was not so warm. This is something that's just really on the move. And hour by hour by hour, you can just feel it building and building and building. There's still a little cold breeze being by near the ocean. So humility, 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 humility. No matter how far along you are. No, the body just goes along for the ride. So don't worry about the body. You know, it goes along for the ride. I've had a problem here with my range of motion in my arm. You know, very, very bad. Never had anything like it. But I keep saying, well, you know, it seems like there's just hideous problems there, but I just have to believe that they'll clear up as I go forward. But I have a history of that happening to me with problems and illnesses just dissolving and just going away as I continue to work on the wow. So, to go reiterate here, encapsulate what we've said, talking about this possible vision of light around everything, this needs to be consciously accepted. It is the goal. Jesus says this is a very realistic goal for us that we can reach. And this then gives us this feeling of a commonality of abstraction to everything, because everything equally has this light around it. And it lets us know that everything is actually abstract. Abstraction is not being defined at all by form, which means our identity is not being defined by a form at all. So it brings us tremendous relief to our mind in some way. And we can build up towards it, and then it will, you know, very quickly just sort of move in like this high pressure system of heat waves moved in. And based on the dream I had last night, maybe it's very close to happening for me. So we're talking about the wow of this realization, that we don't need any status for this. It's simply that we show up and desire to have this experience. That's it. That is the only status there is. And then we need to, you know, this changes the whole, our whole expectation of our future and the past too, because this then puts a new light on the past entirely. Like, oh, this was all a preparation for this. It wasn't what people thought it was, or even what I thought it was, or, you know, what the world thought it was at all. It really was legit. It really was preparing. Wow, this really did have a good ending. Wow, I thought it would be no good ending. Well, it had a fantastic ending. You know, I succeeded. You know, after all this, it's just, and then my future, oh my gosh, no more affliction. I'm, you know, on and on and on and on and on. The expectations just get totally flipped. So this is why it's so shocking. Because we have severe doubts that maybe we'll ever succeed because of our status. I think, I don't have the status. And now to find out we succeeded and the status wasn't needed, and oh my gosh, puts total new light on our life, doesn't it? Sheds new light on our life. Validates it. Extreme validation. And yet we have to just take that in stride, you know. So this is what the wow of it. We work through the shock in advance, step by step. So be very conscious of this wow, which sometimes I'm not, but whenever I am, get massive relief and just click right back into wisdom, just like that. You're centered in wisdom. I wish every day could be a hot summer day. Awesome. There's something apocryphal about it. It's like we're in a sort of a different world. Something very self-reflective about it. commonality of experiencing, right? When you're with people, when it's just a blistering hot day, you're all having this commonality of experience that you can very effectively relate on that too, right? Like, wow. And look at each other and just kind of nod and just like, yeah. But I found that people hate to have a commonality of experience. They're very uncomfortable with that. They want to say, no, I'm special. I'm unique. I'm special. Well, I don't have a commonality experience with you at all. This is what I get from most people. Now, I remember at the Antelope Poppy Preserve in California, which has the world's greatest growth of poppies occasionally when the conditions are right. And I think it was like 2001, was it that I went there? Or two? Or three? I can't remember exactly what year that was. Maybe it was 2003. Yeah. It was just so stupendous that everybody just drove off the side of the road. They couldn't even drive hardly, really. I couldn't drive, because I couldn't take my eyes off of it. That's how beautiful and stupendous it was. It's astonishing. Never seen anything like it. I never expected to see anything like this. It was completely outside the realm of what of anything I ever expected to see. And so everybody's just out of cars, wandering around, taking pictures, laughing, and everybody's smiling at each other. And everybody knew why we're here and why we're smiling. And we said, we're having this common experience. We're having this common experience. And so everybody was, you know, their barriers were down, you know, for a little while. And it was just an amazing spiritual experience. People from all over the world were there. And it didn't matter what their race was or language or culture. None of it mattered. Because we all knew why that we were having this common experience that was just blowing our minds. Everybody's mind was just blown. No question about it. I mean, the fragrance was just like honey in the air. It was just a beautiful blue day. I mean, you were like in a different world. And we were like, wow, we've just been transported to the new world. Yeah. I smiled and waved and smiled and thumbs up, and people would, you know, hi, and everybody was so friendly and happy, and it's like, why can't life be like this all the time? And then, of course, then after that, it all settles down into this, you know, unique, concrete uniqueness, you know, special, I'm special, I'm special, I'm special. I'm not, you know, I don't have commonality with any you know, with anybody else kind of thing, or this fake commonality, not the abstract commonality. And desire to, you know, everyone to wear different clothes. It's you know, I just, that's a tough one to get. You know, I'm comfortable just shorts and a t-shirt. But, you know, people, you know, think, well, I should dress up a little more. But I don't get the fashion in terms of people have to wear something different every day. They have to wear, make sure that what they're wearing, nobody else is wearing. You know, this just reinforces this idea of concrete separationness. You know, I'm special, 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 special. I don't share a boundary with anybody. I'm you know, this, I'm a unit, a special unit, individual, separate. And this goes back to our saying that this God we've imagined of guilt, judgment, the God of judgment, is outside our mind. It has to be in order to effectively judge our death. And then inform us that we truly died and bring us back to life. So from this, we feel that we're outside the mind of everybody else, you know, that we're outside the one mind, we're special, we're unique, and we've got to express this uniqueness through our fashion, our clothing, hairstyles, everything. Women are freaked out. For instance, they could go to an award show and they're wearing, two women wearing the exact same dress by the same designer. Oh my gosh, the designer catches hell for that. I mean, if it's the same designer, holy cow, they'll never go, they'll lose their job. Nobody will see them again. That's how intense this, you know, this specialness is. And everybody's there, and they're all, you know, dressed in these different confections, you know. See, I'm unique. I'm special. Look at me. I'm you know, really... This represents a love of form, love of specialness, and belief in this imaginary God of judgment and this whole plan of being greater than God. But, you know, wear whatever you want to wear, but don't pay too much attention to it, actually. Is it comfortable? Fine. I say just simple monotones, you know. tone down your focus on the body, because bodies, if we look at things, we don't see the commonality really. Everyone's form is different. So we see the differences. Well, sure, we all have eyes and nose, but the commonality that we're trying to get to is this light, the tinges of light around everything. At that point, it doesn't matter what anyone's wearing, the fashions doesn't matter at all, or what their body looks like doesn't make any difference. The tinges of light are still around them and around everything. Jesus says ultimately you don't even see the body at all, you just see a ball of light from where bodies are. But nature, you see the tinges of light. That way you really feel the commonality of everyone, right? That just there's all this equal light, right? Formless light, boundaryless light, the definition of free light. The presupposition here is we all love form. That's why we're here. So to catch a mate, you know, people dress up and say, look how beautiful my form is. Look how attractive it is. Look how different it is. Look how unique it is. Look how special it is. You won't find this anywhere else. And they're banking on the love of form to be attracted to that. But the love of form is based on fear. It's a fear-based universe, fear-based world, fear-based ideology. This is why people, you know, are constantly dressing up and making up and trying to look uniquely attractive. So, because of the love of form. Whereas if you're getting away from that, it doesn't really matter. You're not even paying attention. What are people wearing? What are they looking? What's the ornamentation? Whatever. You're not even looking at them. It's not relevant at all. You're looking for an abstract commonality to everyone. An abstract, not a concrete commonality. Like, gee, we all have legs and feet, aren't we the same? No, an abstract commonality. A non-definable commonality. So this tinges of light would give us that non-definitional commonality, abstract commonality. That's what we're looking for. But in any case, we're not attracted to anybody for any reason. Sometimes people try to reverse it and act dress real plain. They say, oh, you're not attracted to form, well, then you'll love me because I'm not attracted to form. Look how attractive this body is to you now because it's not so attracted to form. This is, you know, also a play like the 60s that was played out too. Look how natural and hippie I am. I'm not into fashion. And that, you know, it's the same thing. Look how attractive my form is to you now because I'm not so into attractive form. That's still focused on concrete, definitional identity, right? So that's just another trap. That's like these huge companies trying to do low budget, I'm not gonna name anybody, trying to do real low budget commercials. Like, wow, you know, yeah, we're not some huge corporation. We're not pumping a bunch of money into advertising. Look at this low budget. We just had some guy with a camcorder going around taking some photo, you know. And people say, oh, we can trust this company. They're old fashioned, you know. No, it's marketing. It's still marketing. So the safe way is just keep going on the spiritual path of walking together in the wow. And automatically you will get less and less interested in bodies, less and less interested in bodies, whether they look plain or not plain, whether they're dressed up or not dressed up so much. Whether it's just a plain cake or all fancy cake, you know, just, no, I'm not into cake. Speaking of cake, that sounds like a good doom food, doesn't it? Double dark chocolate. I think I might get some of that, actually. Yeah. Well, whipped cream, there's a good doom food, absolutely. They're about finished here, I'm getting close. Yeah, vanilla ice cream, chocolate, double chocolate cake, whipped cream. Today, you know, what's today? Today, you have anything to eat today? No. Maybe some cinnamon toast. What time is it? It's like 3:00 in the afternoon. I haven't had anything to eat. had a potato chip. Maybe some people want to go on a fast, a doom fast. You know, that's possible too. Possible doom coming up in September. From, you know, this isn't. Can you know it? It again, I root against it. I root absolutely root against it. No matter how tough things are, we have to keep proceeding and keep doing right spiritual practice and just stick it out. You know, there's no other way around it. Yeah, so we just ask the Holy Spirit for help and perseverance here. But there certainly seems to be doom on the radar, and hopefully it can disappear off the radar as we said we bring things into manifestation through our mind, through our will, desire. So if we desire to experience something, it will come into the experiencing, will happen for us. So if you get a lot of people in the world who want catastrophe, that's a problem. Just say no to catastrophe. Just say no. Have a positive feeling like it will not happen. I disallow it. Don't need it. And the most powerful practice is zero it out. I absolutely want it, and I absolutely don't want it. And this leads us closer into abstraction. When we have the experience of abstraction, the commonality of abstract definition, freeness of tinges of light everywhere, we'll say, hey, we don't need any catastrophe at all. Are you kidding? Let's keep the world the way it is. It's beautiful. I mean, it is beautiful. When I talk about nature worship, I mean worshiping the cycles of nature, birth, death, reproduction, planting, sowing, you know, food, all the different seasons, and, you know, but as far as seeing nature as beautiful, that's not the same thing as nature worship. That's honoring our creativity. I'd like the day just to stay just like this. I don't need the seasons and cycles, really, but just as it is right now. Just the beauty of it, sure. I mean, nature can seem to be very, very beautiful. And keep trying to look at more and more diffuse and let's go for the tinges of light around it. By managing our wow, being aware of it, experiencing it, accepting it, embracing it. Full on doom food day. Oh, what am I talking about? I had pizza. What am I talking about? I did eat. What am I talking about? Of course, pizza. And double dark chocolate. You know, ice cream, lemonade. It's hot enough. Perfect excuse for some doom food. The doom diet. Guaranteed to gain 10 pounds. Some about having some excess poundage is you feel less impulsive, as which is can be helpful. You think, no, I just want to sit here and contemplate and look at the wow and work on that. So I decided not to work out, not to get in shape, and hopefully that's a good decision. Because when you do that, it's really a real commitment to trying to keep, you become aware of your body image so much more, and you're trying to exercise, and you're trying to make progress, and it becomes an obsession. I just said, I don't have time, really, to be in shape. I've got to work on this. Spiritual shape is better than physical shape. And when you try to be obsessed with both, you'll end up shortchanging both. You can't do either really, really well if you try to do both. We need to do something really well, and this is full stop in the wow. Walking together in the wow, we need to do that really well. This is what we're doing really well. So again, an abstract commonality of non-definitional identity, shared in common with all, is what we really want. That's really our goal. So we see that everything is tinged with this abstract non-definitional quality, and that therefore this is all seamlessly in common with everything. And then we start to remember our true identity. You know, this is really the way that it really is, that none of this form can define what we are at all. So we are really after this goal now. So keep at it, keep working at it. I will try. We'll see about new videos. You know, this is just hit. It's sometimes the inspiration's there, sometimes it's not, as far as graphics and stuff.